a little boy went out to play. When he opened his door, he saw the world. As he passed through the doorway, he caused a reflection. Evil was born. Evil was born and followed the boy.
Hi, my name is Michael, and this is a review I've wanted to do for a long time now, but it's baffled me. I was stumped. I wanted to do this forever, but I have no idea how to do it. Do I want to make this a long script and do it as a narrative version, or do I want to do it extemporaneously? And I finally decided I'm just going to try to get whatever random thoughts I have out on this, because this is a review about Inland Empire, one of David Lynch's films, his last feature film, by the way, that he made over 10 years ago now, and it is almost impossible to review or to talk about. It feels like trying to review one of the new episodes of the new Twin Peaks. You can sort of relate what happens, I guess, but describing it, it's meaningless because the feeling of it is what's going on. And this is much more extreme than a movie like Eraserhead, a movie like Mulholland Drive. Both of those movies were, you know, as weird as they were, had a much more clear narrative going, especially Mulholland Drive. There was a question asked, or many questions asked, in the first half of the movie, and in the second half of the movie is the answer. That is not what's going on with Inland Empire. It is, I like to describe Lynch's movies and that kind of weirdness as sort of like an island of stability, where that's surrounded by an ocean of weirdness. And the island is the stable, normal, traditional, regular, everyday things, of which there are an abundance in Blue Velvet and Wild at Heart, and even to some degree in Mulholland Drive and Eraserhead. But then we dip off into the ocean of weirdness. But the stability of that rock, of that island there in the middle of it, is what makes the weirdness stand out. It's sort of like if you swear, maybe what, you know, 99% of what you say is normal, and then every now and again in an extreme circumstance, you yell out a swear word really loud. It has power and potency and meaning to it. But if you have this never-ending coprolalic stream of swear words all the time, it doesn't mean anything. It's pointless. And that's a lot of what happens in Inland Empire. It is a David Lynch film with just the weirdness in it, and none of the narrative normalcy linking everything together. And like in a song, I think there has to be sort of a dissonant quality here and there, or a bad note or an off note thrown in here and there in order to make everything else stand out. All of the normal tonal stuff has to exist to make the atonality mean something later on that you can sort of dip your toe into. But here, it's just wild craziness. When I first saw this movie around 10 years ago, I did not like it at all. And I was shocked because this is the first thing I'd ever encountered from David Lynch that I didn't like. I liked everything. All of his standard movies, Blue Velvet, Wild at Heart that everybody knows, Eraserhead I loved, Mulholland Drive. I wasn't crazy about Lost Highway, and I'm still not, but I gave it a pass. I didn't hate it. I loved Twin Peaks, of course. But this movie, it really hit me hard. You know, I love Dune, even. That's how much I like David Lynch. I love Dune. I love The Straight Story, Elephant Man. But this movie I did not like at all when I first saw it. And I felt stupid for buying the DVD. I just assumed that I was going to like it because, hey, it's David Lynch. How am I not going to like this? I'm a fanatic for this guy. Only Stanley Kubrick is a director that I like more. So when I watched it, I was really disappointed. The movie is the most difficult of his works to get into, most especially because it is 3 hours long. 3 hours! You could theoretically watch 2 whole movies in the time it takes you to watch this one. The origin of this movie is strange. It is actually it began as a series of short films that David was working on for his website, and then he sort of haphazardly knitted and stitched them together, and it has a quality of that. I love reading, but I love reading nonfiction. It's very rare for me ever to sit down with a long fiction book. Almost always it's science fiction. However, I'm actually quite interested in short works. I love, for instance, reading a collection of short stories by my favorite sci-fi author, Philip K. Dick. I love Jorge Luis Borges collections like Ficciones. That's one of the things I love to sit down and read. Stanislaw Lem also has a collection called, I think it's called A Perfect Vacuum of Short Stories, and I prefer that. And that's what this feels like. It's a movie, but it's not a feature film. It is a collection of short stories around a sort of vague theme. And it really does feel like sitting down and the visual equivalent of reading something by Borges. When I'm reading 10 to 15 short stories of his. The story, and I'm going to try to kind of describe the plot to this, because I've gone all this time without even trying to do it, is theoretically about Laura Dern. Now, her character starts out with a name, but that is a little bit strange. Her name is Nikki, but she's not playing this character throughout the entire movie, I think. She sort of flits in and out of various characters in various settings throughout the entire movie. There is a vague thread carrying everything through of Laura Dern's character being a movie actress who lives a very glamorous lifestyle, and she has a mansion and a butler and a maid, and she's very wealthy, and she's taking the lead role in a film which seems like a silly potboiler set in the Deep South, which kind of is redolent of Wild at Heart almost, or Southern Gothic type films that were heavily influenced, a big influence on Wild at Heart, like The Fugitive Kind, which is another great movie. That's where the snakeskin jacket thing that Nicolas Cage wears comes from. And while they're making it, there is an increasing lack of normalcy going on. Everything is drifting off. Once again, we're not on that island of normalcy. We are just plunged right into the ocean of weirdness. In fact, that's a theoretical name for the title of this, Inland Empire, which, if you don't know, is the name of an area in California. The Inland Empire is a large land area to the north of LA. I think it's in Central California, if I remember correctly. And theoretically, Inland Empire is kind of a way of saying inner space. A good way to look at this movie is that it's kind of a science fiction film, but instead of going off into outer space, they drift in to the inner space of the mind. The way that people process thought and memories and ideas and concepts as human beings is not normal, it's not logical, it's not the way that a human sentience can rationally explain things. We process memories and feelings and ideas and thoughts in a bizarre, uncomfortable, and dreamlike way deep inside of our minds. And this feels like a real dream. Now, dreaming has always been a major part of David Lynch's work, especially in Twin Peaks, but also Blue Velvet, Wild at Heart. A sort of dreamlike atmosphere is always present. But it was always a narrative structure and movie with a dream feel to it. This is like if someone actually plunked down and actually filmed a dream. It's almost like a cinema verite version of a David Lynch film. And what I mean by that, because it's a very strange thing to say, is that a cinema verite documentary is one where you are deliberately not trying to tell a narrative. You're not trying to tell a story that really happened with real footage of real people. You're just plunking a camera down and observing and just watching and sort of hoping that it forms or coalesces into a film that you edit together. And that's what this feels like. You really are just it's all of the weird scenes stitched together with nothing connecting them.
Hey! Look at me. And tell me if you've known me before. Yes. We will do that.
Where's the paper towels?
And it's somewhat difficult to watch, especially if you go in thinking it's a narrative movie. Usually I don't like spoiling films for people, but you really have to go into this movie knowing at least vaguely what you're getting into. If you want to go into Blue Velvet or Wild at Heart, this ain't it. This is not meant to be watched or viewed in a narrative sense. It is just meant to sort of, you have to just sit back, surrender your willpower, and let the movie wash over you. There really is no way to understand it. You just have to feel the movie. That's what you have to do with this. You can't, you couldn't possibly understand what's going on most of the time. Roger Ebert, I believe in his review of this, a rare good review of David Lynch's, he used to despise David Lynch back in the day. He hated Blue Velvet, Wild at Heart, everything he had to do with it. He even had a ludicrous review of The Elephant Man, which I strongly suggest you read if you want to laugh at how ridiculous it is. But he loved this movie and gave it 4 stars. And he says, I believe in that review, that at the beginning, Grace Zabriskie, and I showed that clip earlier, comes in and says a weird story. She has an Eastern European accent, and she sort of casts a gypsy spell over the proceedings, and that's really what ends up occurring. As Laura Dern's character takes on the role and begins rehearsing and filming some of her scenes, she gradually experiences this weird sensation of something being wrong and things seeming less and less real. And we learn a very scary story from the director about it.
On High and Blue Tomorrows is in fact a remake. Anyway, the film is never finished. Something happened before the film was finished.
I don't understand. Why wasn't it finished?
Well, after the characters had been filming for some time, they discovered something inside the story. That the two leads were murdered.
So there was something in the movie or something like that? And apparently the lead actors were mysteriously killed, and it happened in Europe somewhere. It is a really creepy thing that's going on. And she begins to feel as if she is her character from the movie, which is the ultimate nightmare of an actor. It really feels like a horror movie for the concept of acting. When you're an actor, you take on the role, you pick it up, you become this character. The character enters you, and you live through the character, and you are the one that are driving the character. You are in control. But a horror movie, what happens? You don't control the character. You read this script and a curse is cast on you and you become the character. And the character possesses you. It was only after watching Twin Peaks over and over and over again that I realized that there is some sort of weird possession angle going on in Inland Empire that I didn't get my first couple of viewings. I realized that because Bob and the other weird spirits there were possessing people and taking control of them, that's very similar to what's going on here, except an actor has a weird magic spell cast on them by this script, and suddenly they start becoming the character in the movie. And isn't that the ultimate horror, that you're not in control, that story is in control, you are allowing yourself to become this person? And that's a magnificent story for an actor. Unfortunately, there's very little to explain beyond that. It's just a succession of scenes, partially as Nikki, partially then as the character, partially maybe as some other character. And of course, that Laura Dern is inhabiting that's not the character even in the movie. It doesn't feel like it. It feels like she's just, a prostitute, weirdly, living in this tiny little scuzzy house somewhere out in the wilderness. And maybe that's also some sort of weird acting thing going on there. An actor might say in their dark moments, maybe I'm not a great thespian, maybe I'm not an entertainer, maybe I'm just a whore that uses that, that people use in order to feel things. And that's all I do. I just prostitute myself with these stories all the time. The film looks horrible. I'm sorry to say this, but I despise this kind of filmmaking, this modernist digital filmmaking. And it was made on a tiny little digital camera that unfortunately David Lynch broke my heart with and apparently fell in love with. He teased me for so many years with this amazing work in Blue Velvet and others, and he is a painter. He actually does paint things. He's an amazing artist. And when he makes films, they look like Kubrick's movies in that they are paintings. Instead of using the movement of the camera to film something mundane that exists, he is an amazing artist who shows us the grandeur and beauty and wonder within the frame. But here, everything is kind of ugly and dirty. There's a few scenes that are very interesting that look wonderful, But most of it is sort of, it's nasty. I don't like looking at it. I don't like that kind of movie, that kind of digital camera film. I think I don't even like calling it film. There is no digital film. Film is celluloid, period, point blank. There's actually a documentary that was done, narrated, I believe, by Keanu Reeves, where they explore this dichotomy of film versus digital film. And I believe David Lynch came out eventually in favor of the digital film, because he must have, at least, if he liked it here so much. But there are a lot of bizarre close-ups, like getting so close up you can see people's eye boogers. Like, he intentionally is screwing around with this by showing things that are too close up, like a badly framed shot.
And he said that I would know who it was.
How are you going to kill this person?
With a screwdriver.
Extreme close up!
You got me. It looks weird. The soundtrack is not as amazing as in other movies, in other David Lynch movies. It's more of like an ambient pulse in the background. There's a fairly generic kind of classical sound here and there that sounds something like some bit of nonsense that Hans Zimmer might make for any random action or suspense movie, like a tension hook. And however, there are a couple of amazing songs in it that I love and actually listen to on my iPod just on my own without the movie. They're amazing, that were done by David Lynch. And one of them, this called, I think, Polish Love Song, it actually has this unbelievable a sort of glorious Julie Cruz-esque amazingness, or sort of angelic quality to it, with amazing washes of synth over everything. And it actually sounds amazing. And it actually includes the lines, "Something is happening." That's the chorus of the song, "Something is happening," just like in Twin Peaks. However, having said that, the movie actually contains two of the greatest sequences that David Lynch has ever filmed. They are absolutely amazing. One is where after a good, I would suggest, hour and a half, maybe, of film, so an entire narrative film, an hour and a half to 2 hours, perhaps, of film where Laura Dern's character has been transmogrified from this actor into this whatever, this weird dream character, we actually pan back, shockingly, and see, of all things, a camera. This weird, creepy, alien, robotic camera on this, I don't know what it is. It's sort of over the top of everything and moving around. It looks like some sort of alien proboscis or something. It looks horrifying. Because we realize that she's filming this. Was this a film this whole time? Well, obviously it is a film. We're watching a film. But what exactly is going on here? It's so scary and unsettling to realize, wait a minute, was all of this just something that was being filmed? Or was it real? And it seems like Laura Dern's character is still possessed somehow as she walks off the stage that we didn't know we were even on. And then he films another one of the great sequences here. He goes back to this scary character, this spooky ghost character who's literally called the Phantom, that's been haunting the proceedings of the movie and our character. And it's terrifying. It's legitimately scary. It's wonderful. And I was an adult when I saw that, and I don't scare easily, but that was actually very frightening. The movie also ends in a very peculiar way. It ends with a happy ending, this sort of weird, creepy horror movie. I mean, this is one of the ultimate atmospheric films ever made. The entire movie is just dripping with this incredible sensation, this vague, woolly, atmospheric kind of creepiness about everything. And it is utterly incredible at times. At other times, it's infuriating and I hate it. At other times, I feel like, my God, I'm watching a dream. And this, in some ways, makes Inland Empire one of the greatest films ever made, because movies are, of course, the language of dreams. It is a dream medium. The only time in human history, just over a century ago, maybe a century and a quarter ago, we were able to record essentially human dreams and put them on here. This feels like one of the most dream-oriented films ever made. You can feel things and sense things and understand characters' emotions and ideas and what they're going through, but none of it makes even the tiniest bit of logical sense. There's no narrative tying everything together. Scenes, for instance, don't end. They just stop, and they cut away to something else, and then we'll go back to that story again, and that's exactly what's happening in the new Twin Peaks. The most recent episode that I saw, episode 5, it just felt like tiny snippets of an 18-hour movie. That's how they're filming it. And that's what this feels like. We see bits and pieces all cobbled together. If you thought that Quentin Tarantino in the 1990s was the expert of narrative taking apart and putting things back together out of order, this movie easily overtakes it. It is insane. We don't know when things are happening, where things are happening, what characters we're looking at, why they're doing these things. We only can feel it. You just have to sit back and let it take control. The movie has to possess you, weirdly enough, more possession. They actually cut, I think in the middle of the movie, like exactly an hour and a half in, if I remember correctly, to this strange female character telling this weird story. And Roger Ebert and others have interpreted that as saying, just let it happen. You just have to let the movie wash over you. Throughout all of the film, there's been this weird subtext of Poland. For some reason or another, some characters are Polish, and we go to Poland itself, and it's something else is happening there to another woman that is living a similar life to Laura Dern. So Laura Dern is essentially becoming this character, or she's helping this character live her life, and we actually get, of all things, kind of a happy ending, weirdly enough, as these characters sort of unite and she comes out of the film. And at the end of the movie, she actually sees herself living these incredible emotions on a stage, watching a screen. So we really just have to let this movie happen in front of us and let it take us for a ride. We are in this car, someone else is driving it, and they are going off on their own. And if you can't do that and can't let yourself go, you can't enjoy it. It's kind of like getting drunk. You have to be in the right mood to get drunk or get high, or you're not going to like it, and you're going to fight it, and you're going to hate it. I wanted to make this video especially because I wanted to get my feelings out there, and I wanted to tell people, don't give up on this movie, because I did it. I hated it the first time, but because it was Lynch, I went back a second time, and I found things I liked. I didn't hate it. I didn't love it, though. And then I went back a third time, and I found even more stuff that hit me totally differently. You have to be in the right headspace to see this movie, and I'm a firm believer that you have to be in the right headspace at the right time of day, in the right, exact right mood to enjoy something. At the Cannes Film Festival, for instance, they watched Firewalk with me, supposedly at like 8 a.m. Like, after they had breakfast, they went and watched Firewalk with, Twin Peaks Firewalk with me. And they hated it. And like, yeah, I would hate that movie at 8 a.m. too, after I had my cornflakes. That's not the movie to watch then. This is a movie to start at about 11 p.m. And you'd be done at 2 in the morning. The scenes sort of bleed into one another. It is, it's almost like a plate of food where all of the food and the sauces and everything is all pushing and mixing together, and everything is sort of crossing with everything else. It's a very difficult experience to watch this movie. And I don't blame people for not liking it, because I hated it when I first saw it. But I kept going back, and I kept finding things to love about it. There are so many good things in this movie. But again, it's like a short story collection. You're not going to like every moment. You're not going to understand every moment tied together, because they're not. And you just have to sit there, like Laura Dern's character, watching her own character. Is she possessed by someone else? Is the audience possessed by the movie? Is that how we should watch movies? Are you the one that's being possessed when you're watching the movie and its thoughts and ideas and concepts are flitting away in your mind? Roger Ebert, again, who is not a good authority on David Lynch, let me tell you, he said that David Lynch put his digital virus in me, referencing something from Blue Velvet, and he's right about that. That's what happens. David Lynch is sort of possessing us through this film, and we're watching this weird collection of all these things and ideas that happened in prior Lynch works. We're getting some Laura Lena Herring and Naomi Watts in a very, very peculiar scene, and it's just so worthwhile to actually try it out. So I would recommend everyone do that. You know, just get at the right headspace, maybe have a beer to loosen yourself up, make sure it's late at night, make sure you're relaxed and willing to let this movie wash over you and not spend too much time thinking and try struggling to understand it, because if you struggle against it, if you fight it, you're not going to enjoy it, because the movie has to possess you like a ghost, like Laura Dern's character. And speaking of which, I'm not usually one to go on about this, because I'm more interested in things like cinematography, the direction, the lighting, the music. That's the thing about film that really excites me. So I don't usually go into acting, but Laura Dern in this movie is amazing. And I'm trying to say that with as much power and authority and seriousness as I can muster, because we hear this all the time, every single day. The Hollywood bubble says this again and again and again about so many different actors and so many different things. They can't. They won't face reality and just saying that this was an average performance. Who cares? No one's going to remember this in 10 years, much less 50 years. You know, virtually every Oscar handed out is for some mediocre crap performance. But Laura Dern definitely deserved to win an Oscar here, and of course she didn't, unfortunately. And she is just absolutely stunning in this movie. She is amazing. She's playing 10 different types of person. Like, every scene, she's a different character doing a different thing. She goes from this elegant, upper-class movie actress to this scummy, sleazy, swearing, drunken, sort of low-class woman, to this prostitute, to I don't know what, to something else. And she is absolutely incredible, and it just shows so much range and power and emotion. All of the times you've heard people gush about actors, it's virtually never true. But in this case, just to see Laura Dern's performance, it's worth watching this one.
When I get mad, I really get mad. I gouged a man's eye out when I was 15 once. He was trying to rape me. I mean, fucker had it out. He was pushing my legs apart. Got a finger in his eye socket. Pretty quick, rape was quite a long way off his mind. The ambulance guys, they say, what the fuck happened here? I say, he come to reaping what he'd been sowing, that's what. They say, fucker been sowing some kind of heavy shit.
And I usually hate that. I usually don't care less. You know, one of my favorite movies is 2001, A Space Odyssey. And Cary Doulet is not exactly a great thespian. You know, he's just sort of like interchangeable with the robot, pretty much. I'm not usually one to go on about that, but it is absolutely extraordinary, her role in this. So please, tell me in the comments below what you thought of this movie, if you've seen it, or if you've heard about it, why you haven't seen it, if you've heard about it, but have never gone to it, if something scared you away, if you didn't like it. Tell me if you love this film. Tell me why you do. Tell me what you think about it, what you've interpreted in it. Can you interpret something that I could not? Because I think it's without interpretation. If you interpreted something going on that I didn't mention, please tell me about it. And, you know, I want to know. I want to discuss this movie. This movie I've seen under-discussed when talking about David Lynch. They'll talk about Blue Velvet, Twin Peaks, Wild at Heart, but this one, Mulholland Drive, this one they don't talk about very much because it is so difficult and so hard to get into. And I think it's absolutely amazing. You know, with all the trouble I had with it, with all of the worries and problems I had with aspects of it, especially the ugliness of the style that I really don't like, this very ultra-modern, very 21st century digital style rather than film. But I want to know what you think about it. Tell me what you think. Please like this video if you liked it. I've linked more things here about Twin Peaks, something else I talk about all the time. I'm going to be talking about all of the new Twin Peaks episodes when they come out on the Monday after they come out. So thank you very much for watching this video, and give the movie a shot. You may end up liking it even if you think you hate it like I did. Have a good day.